And that next speaker is of someone who's a very close friend. It's Sue Barrett. Now, Sue Barrett, if you know, industry legend. She's, you know, ex-WGSN, worked at Wrangler, worked at many, many brands, inspired. She's inspired thousands of people from the stuff from her research that she's done. She's giving a presentation about customer profiling and mindsets. It's a pre-recorded set, but she's here with us as well. So she's going to be doing a Q&A with us. So Joanne, if you could play her video.
Hi, my name's Sue Barrett, and I'm a creative consultant with a background in denim design, trend forecasting, and editorial. I started working in trend forecasting even before WGSN had launched, but I didn't leave college with a portfolio that had a really clear destination already mapped out. In fact, far from it. The fashion textiles course that I did at Brighton focused at that time more on creativity than commerciality. But thankfully, the agency I went to see as a fresh graduate saw something in the way that I combined images and moods and suggested I approached some of the then offline trend forecasting companies. So today I wanted to take you back on a bit of a brief journey just to outline my experience of how influencers and consumer focus has changed and evolved over the last sort of 15 to 20 years. So sort of jumping back to, I guess, the late 80s, early 90s, and denim product was then all about durability and less about fashion. It was about as sexy as selling potatoes because there was a lot of flat stonewash. And denim was really sold in independent jeaneries or jean stores or lads and dad stores, as a friend of mine beautifully described it. Or it was sold in department stores like in C&A or mail order catalogues and sent straight to the door. So really not the sort of Gigi boutiques that there are now for buying denim. And one of the big things that was opening up at the mid to end of the 90s was Japanese denim. All eyes were on Japan for their denim masterful collection. So brands like Eversu, and it was worn really dark with really deep turn-ups. So for me as a student at that time, I was buying all of my denim from secondhand stores like Rocket. And then I moved to Belgium at the end of the 90s, and my role was trend and colour analyst for Lee and Wrangler. So at that time, denim sales weren't particularly great. And I was working with the head of product to work out trends that would ensure that Lee and Wrangler design teams created different ranges, even down to different colour palettes, to try and attract different target consumers for each of the brands. So right there is where I got my baptism in denim, working in two of the three most iconic denim brands, learning about brand heritage and icons, and at the same time, a very deep dive into brand restructuring. And my first experience of sales meetings, what shocked me the most was that there was no real design-led process. No, in fact, there was a pile of colour cards from Mills on the table next to a pile of fabric hangers. And Lee and Wrangler were both pan-European companies. So it meant that they had representatives from each of the different countries that they sold to. And the country with the biggest sales volume and the loudest voice would get to choose the colours from the season. And in terms of style, those sales guys with the loudest voice would bring in what they considered to be the best-selling jean in their market, which at the time predominantly was Diesel. So they would bring in magazine cuttings and product from the market, and they would give it to the product developers to create the collection. So very much not set from a design process. The other really important thing to point out is this was pre-internet. So it was all about getting your products to stylists and getting it in front of an editorial team to get your product into magazines. That was your dialogue to consumers, and it was very different to how it is now. Not least because magazines came out every 4 weeks, so you had to really wait for your fashion fix. The top end was still sort of Condé Nast and glossy Vogue and Elle, But there was a sort of more edgy street-led mindset with publications like Face and ID and Dazed and Confused that sort of reflected a gritty subculture, an underground look. And that was where you went to look for your cool street shots and your really cool editorials. So two big things happened pretty much side by side. Zara was a total game changer in the way that people started to shop in Europe. Their stores offered excitement and fast, fun, affordable, catwalk-driven styling and denim that was unbranded but fashion-led. So denim suddenly became part of fashion. Until then, it had been very much about sort of durable product. But the 90s really saw it shift to fun and glamorous and skinny and stretchy. The obvious other big tipping point was the internet. And as a result, the speed at which products could be shared and sold, often through our unconscious, has boomed as a result. There was talk about organic products because it was the rise of organic food, but sustainability and the impact of textiles was something that just really hadn't come to light. It wasn't part of the design process. It wasn't part of the discussion. So the images that we take of ourselves have gone from less than 20 a year to sometimes thousands in a month. But what do consumers really want? Well, to know that, you have to do a deep dive into their world. What do they want from you as a brand? What do they want from your product? How do they want to be seen in the world? What do they stand for? What communities do they associate themselves with? So in every season I've worked on, macro trends have always been the starting point, full of deep dive research that brings into focus what's happening in the world. Consumers are all individual, but they all share one thing, a conscious mindset, and expect a better vision for the future. So let's have a look at one of the four different consumer tribes. Let's call these guys essentialists. You'll find quite a lot of these denim nerds in the denim industry, but what engages them is a powerful denim history narrative, all about purpose-built garments and functional detailing. What's key for them is creating products for life. And why is that? Well, denim is a really unique fabric in that the older it gets, the better it gets. And that's really what lights these guys up. So a bit like tattoos, denim wear lines are like memories. The purists of this tribe are all about virgin to vintage and creating and sharing image galleries based on how many days an item has been worn, how often or little they've been washed. And yes, to some people that's disgusting, and that's a whole other webinar all about antimicrobial denim. But raw or unwashed virgin denim is a key starting point for these guys. And just want to play you a short video from Nudie Jeans that highlights this consumer tribe's connection to their denim.
In August 2016, I got them for our wedding party. What better way to celebrate a wedding party than in denim? And then they have been with me since then and are now up in almost 200 wear days. Those are the pair I come back to and really love. They have never been washed, and I'm not intending to do that either. They're going to live unwashed and raw as long as they exist. I can't get rid of them. They're part of me and my wife's history.
So it's really about a heartfelt connection to a product and to the narrative of a product. So for this consumer, if a brand does not have a soul, it should not exist. So let's have a look at a different kind of consumer perspective. So this is tribe number two, and they reflect an intersection of streetwear, punk self-expression, and digital fashion. As a backlash to mainstream, these guys are sort of the taboo smashers who want to make a statement in a different way. And what's currently engaging this tribe is a new cult underworld fueled by a rise in horror and sci-fi as a new form of escapism. So as anarchic as this consumer appears to be, they still want to be part of the solution for a cleaner planet. So from digital fashion lookbooks and virtual influences through to reimagined product from textile wastes, they're creating their own version of self-expression. So this is all about rebirth, and rebirth of a mindset in which designers need to take a good hard look at themselves and stop making pointless stuff that just looks nice. And that was from a new corporation called Urge that are challenging the way that we create products. So the third consumer tribe is really centered around streetwear, not just as clothing, but as a whole new design ethos that's influenced everything from premium casual wear to modern living aesthetics, and has been a total game changer through giving rise to the resale business model in the market. Streetwear hype really created its own version of a resale market. It's all about the theatre of drops. But it's also about re-embracing fashion for good, clothing as an agent of change, where clothes become billboards and extensions of social media feeds, telling people what you really think and feel.
Our rose-tinted glasses and our closed-eye glances. And if it do be a late night, the kind where my conscience is coughing up some cotton, and I have forgotten that in that it is what makes water drain, and water is draining. Sustaining is the only way of retaining what do exist in bliss and glory. And if it do be a night, and the next day, and a year, and a forever, where together we got enough care to spare, it's the Bear Scouts' honour to find bother, good and proper. And if it do be the kind of conscious late night where I might have found a way to articulate, I say to an empty room that do feel a bit like a big stage, I say, if this do be the earth and you are deserving of a spot on it, you better treat this like your mama's house, because this is collective mother's house. Take off not your shoes but your footprints. Take your carton and put it in the right bin. Pick up your clothes, stitch up that hole, reuse. We don't have no waste in this house. Be conscious, child. Be responsible now. If this do be the kind of late night where we realise it's time to hold up the house.
But it's a community that's full of collaborative spirit and innovation that transcends design and connects with its consumers where they are, online, and often through gaming portals. So the last sort of consumer profile that I want to highlight is one that's getting a lot of airplay right now. This tribe reflects the intersection between rising vintage subcultures and high-end luxury consumers. These guys are engaged by individuality and pre-loved garments, but also about the narrative of craftsmanship and about owning unique one-off pieces. And this is a hugely pivotal and influential business model right now. So this is less about making more stuff to sell, but rather about making it better, so people want to keep it for longer. But it's also about style over fashion, keeping something that you love and altering it so it grows with you over time. So, in a crowded marketplace, fitting in is a failure. Not standing out is the same as being invisible. So you don't get anywhere if you don't push the boundaries. But with 7 billion people on the planet and 100 billion products being created every year, it's really important to understand your audience and understand how to engage or how to disengage them. Thank you.
Wasn't that awesome? I'm just gonna get Sue on now, have a little chat. I love Sue. I've done Sue, hey, you're great. So Sue, obviously the students at Ravensbourne are extremely lucky because you and I are the ones that mentor them. So super lucky they get you for, you know, it's epic. So yeah. So.
I don't know about lucky, but they do get us.
they get us. So we have a lot of fun. And also Jess from yesterday at IME also does teach and has taught at like Ravensbourne too. So there's a lot of big link there. Buzz mindsets are amazing. You know, I was just about to laugh because, you know, I think I'm that video game guy, you know. So I'm this is, yeah, video game culture. And for me, when I remember when I was a student, I always said I wanted to do 3D design so I could design garments for video games. That's honestly the honest reason I got into fashion. I never made it to video games.
This is your moment right now, babe.
You know, I've started doing 3D avatars this year. This could be the time where I switch and that's it. No more. I'll be saving the planet. We've got no questions. Everyone was obviously loved what you did. If there's any questions, guys, we've got Sue Barrett for another few minutes before we move on to. Oh, they're coming in now. How inspiring. How was your experience at WSN? How do you manage to be in the next big tribe? So I guess your experience from WSN obviously helped you, I imagine. Of course it did. But it's the Wrangler stuff, I imagine, that got you on the hook, right?
Well, I think when, because at the 90s, it was like I joined at the time when people were buying Abercrombie and Fitch cargos. And you could only get it in America. And people were kind of obsessed with it. And one of the reasons that they were doing this restructuring of the brand was because how can we compete in the cargo business? And they actually created this product that was like cargos by the makers of Wrangler. So being part of that whole restructuring and going, you know what, Lee, you're going to be like this and you can have those colours, and Wrangler, you're going to be like this. It was the biggest deep dive into, consumer values. And in those days, it was not videos and pretty pictures. It was a man that came in with like the biggest sheath of numbers. And you know, we're talking about street shots. One of the things I had to do was go out and literally photograph all the stores that had Lee and Wrangler. And some of them were great. Some of them really were the lads and dad stores. And I would just be photographing people on the street, but it was like proper old school, camera where you then got the photographs and had to print them out. So I've got some really sort of like random pictures of like, okay. And we had to go to every country. Like we'd be in Hamburg photographing the really boring consumer, then trying to find some cool tattooed guy. So yeah, it was very sort of early in my understanding of denim.
The early part of your presentation, you talked about when you were at Wrangler and they were designing, there was a color card on a table and there was a guy with a chart with a tick box of what you had to design this season. And some companies are still like that now, you know, so it's very much like that. So it's all about how you can be creative within those confinements, isn't it? You still have to research, as Marlin's saying, if you don't do good research and then you tick the boxes that the product guy wants you to tick. That's the hardest part really, isn't it? But yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I just like to all the whittled on.
So I'm sorry, I should have cropped it, but I think we're out of time, aren't we? I think we've got to go to Laura.
We're going to go over to Laura very, very soon. Let's just double check one more second. But there are some questions here, but if you don't mind answering them, it's just about good presentation. Everyone's just saying how good it was and they really enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for your presentation. I know.
Can I just show something really quickly for the denim community? Just wanted to hold these up for you guys. There was a little bit of chat about the fact that I used to wear these many moons ago. Of course, I was never going to put these on. I'm going to turn it into a pencil case. I had to share.
Thank you for your time. I know you and I, all of us, are really busy, so I really appreciate your time putting together this presentation and like pre-recording it, and it does take a lot of energy, but thank you so much. It was really, really enjoyable, and I loved seeing the four different concepts and the four different things and the customer mindsets. Thank you very much.